Finally tonight, another take on the financial crisis and the bubble that popped. Jeffrey Brown talks to Michael Lewis about his new book.
When the stock market tumbled and major financial institutions collapsed in late 2008, it was a surprise and shock to many Americans. But for a few people deep inside the world of mortgage-backed securities and complex derivatives, it was just what they'd expected and even bet on. Some of their stories are told and the larger financial drama explained in The Big Short. The author is Michael Lewis, a journalist and writer whose previous books include Liar's Poker and The Blind Side. Welcome to you.
Thank you.
Your way into this is not the big epic sweep, but these few characters who were running against the pack. Why was that a way in?
Well, it was a fantastic story that I couldn't believe hadn't been told, that the financial world had essentially, between 2005 and 2007, organized itself around a giant bet. And the entire financial system, but for a few, were on one side of the bet. They were betting on the subprime mortgage market. And on the other side were a handful of people who sort of saw what was happening.
What did they see? What did they see that everybody else didn't see?
They saw, different people saw different things, but they saw the corruption of lending standards in the subprime mortgage market. They saw the corruption of the ratings agencies that led to bonds that should never have been rated being rated AAA. They saw the investment banks, the large Wall Street firms, which had always kind of been the smart money at the table, becoming the dumb money at the table. I mean, historically, the last thing you wanted to do was be on the other side of a trade of Morgan Stanley or Goldman Sachs. They saw that there was a trade to be on the other side
suddenly
of it.
Made good sense.
Yeah. And so, but the characters were so rich. I mean, and what I'm writing is a narrative. It's not an editorial. And the characters are sort of the oxygen for any narrative. So they led me to this way of explaining the crisis.
There are a number of characters. Just tell us about one. Like Steve, is it Eisman?
Steve Eisman.
Eisman.
Eisman was one of the first two or three original analysts of subprime mortgage originators back when they were first kind of invented as an idea in the 90s. And he had come to see this interface that was growing between Wall Street and middle and lower middle class America. And it's a different interface than Wall Street's usually involved in America's assets. You know, it's stock market decisions. This was Wall Street getting very involved in people's debts. And he saw this relationship very cynically. In fact, he starts his life on Wall Street as a kind of conservative Republican, and by the time he's done, he's almost a socialist. And it's because he sees essentially the systematic exploitation of people who are on the other side of Wall Street's trades.
You know, but what's funny, though, I mean, they're the heroes. He and the others are the heroes of your book. They're not real here. I mean, they're doing this to make money.
Yes.
They make a lot of money betting against these institutions, but essentially betting against the U.S. economy in a sense.
Yes, they're not real. They're complicated heroes.
Yeah.
I mean, they're heroes in the sense that if everybody had seen the world as they saw the world, this crisis never would have happened.
And they wouldn't have gotten rich.
And they wouldn't have gotten rich. And they're also, you know, in each case, they did sound alarms. I mean, they were screaming to high heaven that this was what was going on was crazy. I mean, one of the characters actually bothers to go to the SEC and try to explain to the SEC what they think is kind of a fraudulent, rigged system. So in that sense, too, they were useful citizens of the republic. But it's true. It's a very curious tale in which the heroes are betting on the collapse of the financial system.
No. I think what people still debate here, I mean, what unfolds through their story and their discovery is, and you've just said, the sort of greed, corruption, venality, everybody is sort of gaming the system. I think what people still debate or wonder about, is it mass delusion that happened, or is it acting with intent?
Well,
with bad intent?
This is a great question. It's a question that they themselves never completely resolve. And it's part because it's hard to know what lies inside the hearts of others, but part because actually they found a great deal of evidence that the other side of their trades were just deluded, that they actually didn't understand what was going on. That in fact, this was less a story of kind of systematic criminality than it was a systematic misperception, that you had these facts in the financial world and you could arrange them into different kinds of pictures, and the financial system arranged it into the facts into a pretty picture, and that was a false picture. And the question was kind of why it did that, and it did that because there were incentives not to see the world as it was. I mean, people were being paid a lot of money to ignore pretty basic simple things that were right under their nose.
There's a line where you write of two of your characters. They had always sort of assumed that there was some grown-up in charge of the financial system whom they had never met. Now they saw there was not.
Yes, that they were the grown-ups. This was a revelation to many of them, because they just assumed it was very odd that they were in this position of making this bet, because they were constitutionally essentially value investors in the stock market who had figured out that they couldn't make their investments not understanding this strange, crazy thing that was happening in the lending markets. And so they had to actually kind of, as innocents, learn about how the bond markets worked in America. And at every stage, they're shocked that there isn't some grown-up who's saying, this is wrong, you shouldn't be doing this. And so that they find that it's this headless beast. And that's what enables me to explain it. That's what you asked me why I chose this story, mm-hmm. because they themselves had to figure it out. And so it's a kind of, it's an adventure for them. I mean, they are learning as they go.
So here we are, still, we're in Washington. There's still all this talk about financial reform. We keep reporting on this program all the time. What do you see? I mean, has there been any change? Has there been any progress?
There hasn't been change, but there has been progress. I think that broadly, you can say that the powers that be, the general thing is generally true about everybody the authorities who have been dealing with the crisis is that they're all people who didn't see it coming. They're all people who are in positions of authority when it happened. They didn't see it coming, unlike these characters. They have been dealing with the symptoms of the crisis. They've not dealt with the cause. There's been no meaningful change in the way Wall Street is. It's worse in a way, because one of the problems on Wall Street was that these firms were playing with shareholders' capital rather than their own money, which caused them to take some pretty silly risks. Now they're playing with taxpayer guaranteed money, and you can only imagine the sort of risks they might run if they're allowed to run them. However, I think the sort of the basic relationship between the Wall Street man and the rest of the society has shifted pretty dramatically. Mm-hmm. I think that it's gone from they've gone from being sort of an unquestioned master class to being, well, first wards of the state, and now almost enemies of the state.
Right, a lot of anger.
There's a lot of anger. And so I think that's going to find a political expression.
All right, the book is The Big Short. Michael Lewis, nice to talk to you.
Thanks for having me.